On this week's Xamarin Show, I have my good friend David back on to tell you about all the cool little tiny bits and improvements in Xamarin Forms 3.1 with platform specifics and some things that are just baked in. Welcome back, everyone, to the Xamarin Show. I'm your host, James Montemagno, and today I'm really crazy, ridiculously excited to have my very good friend, David Ortnow, back on the show. How's it going, buddy?
It's going well. I feel like we just talked. How's it been for you?
Nonstop, just Xamarin shows all day, because there's so many new, amazing features in Xamarin Forms that we just got to show.
Absolutely. Yeah, fantastic.
So maybe people haven't seen some of our other videos, which we'll, of course, put in the show notes, but maybe tell everyone a little bit about who you are and what you do here at Microsoft.
Sure. So David Ortnow, I am a senior program manager for the mobile development tools team. I work primarily with the Xamarin mobile SDKs and with a strong focus on Xamarin Forms. But I'm also now working with Xamarin iOS, Xamarin Android, and the components team. So what I do is I talk to customers. I find out, what are you doing with the app, with Xamarin in general? What are you building? What's working well for you, and where can we improve? And come up with some ideas to really hopefully drive things forward for you, make you more successful with what you're doing, and delight you, and make sure that Xamarin is something you love to use. Go back to the engineering team, work up those ideas, and hopefully move everything forward and make it awesome.
Awesome. So what are you going to show us today? I know there's a lot of new things, and we were talking, so what do you want to show us?
So one of the coolest things that's been happening over the course of this year so far, 2018, is that we have this F100 initiative, which I'll kind of break that down. So this is a collaboration with a number of community contributors, and we have an awesome group of contributors that are real faithful, and we're always looking for more contributors, by the way. And so these are a lot of little things that developers were telling us, hey, why doesn't Xamarin Forms just do this? I have to write custom code for this, or custom platform stuff for this. So what I have here on my screen is the enhancements board up on our GitHub. So this is, if you go to our projects and you look at all the enhancements that we've got going on, a lot of this is stuff that is being done by community contributors. And some of it also is being done by people across Microsoft, which is awesome to have those contributions as well. So it's things like progress bar height, left aligned toolbars, and things like this. And what you see on the screen here, there's like 30 some odd that are already completed. And so today, what I wanted to do was walk you through some of those things that are already shipping today in Xamarin Forms 3.1.
Cool. I see that some of them seem like features that are for all different project types, but then some of them are just for like one or two. Is that where platform specifics comes in then?
Exactly. Yeah. So when we have something that makes sense across UWP, iOS, and Android as our first tier, top tier platforms that we're looking at, then we'll absolutely make those features at the forms level across the board. But if something is very specific to iOS or Android or UWP or, you know, any of those other platforms that community contributors have been adding into Xamarin Forms, then a platform specific is the best way to achieve that. So we have documentation up on Microsoft Docs that will tell you all about the platform specifics that are already available. So you can see that here in my browser. And then you can go find out how you would perhaps go about building your own platform specifics if this is something that you wanted to do. Typically, for most end developers, people that are using Xamarin Forms, a effect is more appropriate way to go about implementing something that is platform specific. But when we bake something into core, it usually ends up being a platform specific. So I have a demo here with a couple of different things that I wanted to highlight from the 3.1 release.
Cool.
And what I wanted to start off first with were a couple of the platform specifics. And then the rest of these, the entry editor stuff, works across the board.
Oh, cool. So we have a bunch of kind of little tweaks and tunes to platforms that, you know, developer like me, I'm always like, oh, I would need to do that one thing, so I got to go do a bunch of work. But it seems like when it gets to the level that everyone kind of agrees, like, hey, maybe even though it's only for Android, let's just put it inside of Xamarin Forms.
Yeah, exactly. And it's a situation where most developers end up building out their own little toolkits to be able to do those things, to fill those gaps and fill those needs.
Got it.
And by implementing some of these things, you no longer have to. So Android bottom tabs, I know you were super excited about, and I was very excited about, and as I heard from the community, everybody was very excited about. So let's take a look at how you would go about implementing bottom tabs. So what I have here is I have the file new project that you get when you just start anything, right? Yep. And this is the one that's not blank. It's the other one. So it starts out with a tabbed page. And so normally what I would get is on iOS and Android, these tabs on iOS would be at the bottom because that's the way that Apple has always done it. And on Android, it would be at the top because yep. traditionally that's how Google had done it. However, in recent time, Google decided, hey, why don't we let people start putting them at the bottom now? Which, you know, creates row upon row of buttons, but it opens up some nice options. And developers were telling us, we really need to be able to do this in Xamarin Forms. Help us out.
Yeah, that's nice because I know I'm a pretty big Android fanboy. And they actually have different kind of use cases. And it's nice to at least have your hierarchical kind of navigation be the same between iOS and Android. So like the bottom tabs kind of made me pretty excited there.
Yeah, and definitely a theme from talking to developers using our platform is they want things to look the same on iOS and Android. And when your tabs suddenly are shifting around, you've immediately broken that by default. So here's how you implement a platform specific. First, you need to add the namespace for Android because that's where this platform specific exists to be able to do toolbar placement. It is coming off of the tabbed page because that's the control that we are going to be impacting. And then we're going to tell it that we want the toolbar to be placed at the bottom. Easy as that. What happens is when that layout initially gets rendered, it's going to use the appropriate platform native elements to put those menus at the bottom. So it's the same as you would get if you had done this using Java and Android or C# with Xamarin and Android. So you get it at the bottom. And as soon as you've done that, the first thing you're going to notice, if you hadn't implemented any of the styling that I have here, would be that your buttons now are on a white background because that's what the page background color is. You no longer see the background of the navigation bar, which is what you had when it was at the top, because obviously the navigation bar didn't move, just the menu moved. So the way to get around that, or the way to address that as you're migrating to this bottom menu pattern, is to implement a background color for your bar on your tabbed page. You want to make sure that you have your default bar text color set, but then you have the Android-specific options to say, okay, I want my tab item to be this color, and I've got one with a bit of opacity here, or I want my bar selected item color. When it's selected, I want it to be full-on white. And you get all the Inkwell stuff and everything, too. As a matter of fact, I've got it up and running in my emulator over here. This is Android, right? And so I've got my Inkwell, I've got my different tabs down here, and it's at the bottom. And as I mentioned, this is something that you do once in the app. You can't change this at runtime. So if you try to change this at runtime, you'll get a nice little warning that says, hey, no. We've already generated these renderers. Please don't do that.
Got it. That makes sense. Now, those bar item color and bar selected item color, do those have to do with it being at the bottom, or are those independent? So if I had it at the top, I can then control those colors?
You can control them if you are using this platform specific, yes.
Ah, very cool. Yeah, it's like a whole other thing.
Yeah, it's like a whole other thing.
Very
so
cool.
if I went top here and then reran this whole application, it would pick up those colors.
Oh, very cool. That's also like a nice perk. I didn't even know that until you just showed me that. So that's really cool.
Yeah, it's a brand new hot bits. So a couple other things to call quick attention to. That are part of the 3.1 release. So iOS inherits drop shadows everywhere. So this is another platform specific, and you see that this time my namespace here is iOS. So just flipping that to using the different namespace. And then this actually extends off Visual Element. So any UI element in Xamarin Forms that is based off Visual Element, which, you know, in case you're not aware, is everything, then you can start adding shadows to everything. So you just got to make sure you enable that shadow. You can set the radius, the opacity, and you can see over here in the previewer, I've got a nice black box with a nasty red drop shadow on it. I'm sure that when you go to implement this, it would look much nicer, but I wanted to make sure that that came through on the recording. So
yeah, it looks real good.
Yeah, and then a couple other things here to call focus to. So we've done some really cool stuff to the editors. So let me go back to my demo here because I think it shows it better in the demo. So one of the things that I've needed to write myself in the past is when you have an editor, you don't want it to just be one line. You want it to auto-size for you while you're typing.
Oh, wow. Nice.
So that's pretty hot, right?
Yeah, that's awesome.
So all I had to do here to make that happen was set that auto-size to react to my text changes.
Wow, that's great.
That's pretty sweet. Let's see, what else do we have here? We've got switch color. So traditionally, if you wanted to change that background color of the switch, you had to do a custom renderer. Now you just have a quick property. I've set mine to red. The default the disabled color is unchanged, but the red, it's just a matter of setting the on color. So you see some of these F100s, they're not nearly as complex as those platform specifics. Sometimes it's just a new property that we were able to add to the control to make sure that it was available everywhere.
Yeah, sometimes those little tiny things, right? They make the world of a difference, though.
Yeah, that's why I named this project The Little Things. okay, so if you want to be able to control the return button on an entry, so you see I've got the send button down here in the lower right-hand corner of the keyboard. That was simply by coming here and saying on this particular entry, return type send.
Oh, cool.
So that's a nice little convenience. And then auto capitalization, you want to control the different keyboard flag rules for how your entry should behave. You know, nothing more annoying than when you go to type in your email address, it starts capitalizing things on you.
Yep.
And you're like, dude, I don't do that in my email address. It's all lowercase. Just stop it. So now you get that here too.
Nice. That's nice because also sometimes when people are typing passwords or other things, right, it's super annoying.
Yeah. Yeah, and this is actually a nice little trick. I mean, you can do this stuff in the code behind, in the C# pretty easily. But sometimes this XAML syntax isn't something a lot of people use. But you can use a factory method to go ahead and set your keyboard flags right here in XAML.
Oh, wow.
So that's how I was able to achieve that right there. And I believe, do I have one more down here? Doo-doo-loo. Yeah, so disabling text prediction. So this shows up a bit more nicely in an iOS demo, but if you don't want to have those prompts all the time for text prediction, you can just turn them off. Just simple as this: is text prediction enabled false?
Very nice.
So yeah. So that's kind of the flavor of the F100s. Those are all included in 3.1. And we have quite a few more coming in 3.2, which is, I think, we're currently shipping in pre-release. So look for that on NuGet and check out what we got going on there.
Very cool, David. I mean, I love all this stuff. I geek out on it because all those little small, tiny tweaks, I can get rid of all that other code that I didn't, you know, I had written before, and I can just pull in the features that are in the box now. I just update the NuGet, and I'm off to the races.
Saves you so much time.
Very cool. Well, we'll put all the links in the show notes, to the documentation, to your sample, to the release notes, everything from Xamarin.Forms. David, thanks for coming back onto the Xamarin Show.
Right on. Thanks, James.
Awesome. Well, thanks to everyone for watching, and don't forget to subscribe so you can keep up to date. And if you're over there on YouTube, hit subscribe and ding that bell so you get all of the notifications directly in your inbox. So until next time, I'm James Montemagno. This has been The Xamarin Show, and thanks for watching.